أغمض عينيك وتذكر
أغمض عينيك وتذكر تسبيحا حلوا كالعنبر.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء وسيد المرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Shall we continuing with the explanation of the book compiled by Imam al-Bukhari رحمه الله تعالى. So chapter 124 is cheerfulness towards people. باب الانبساط إلى الناس. And that is to bring happiness, bring cheerfulness to your fellow Muslim. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us that one of the great acts that a Muslim can do to another is idkhal al-surur, is to enter or to make another Muslim happy. To make another Muslim happy by doing something for them or saying something good to them, advising them well, and so on. So the hadith that Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah ta'ala mentions is a beautiful hadith narrated by Ata ibn Yasar. He said, I met Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As radiyallahu anhuma and asked him, tell me of how the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is described in the Torah. He answered, yes, by Allah he is described in the Torah partly as he is described in the Quran. And then he quoted the ayah where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ya ayyuha an-nabiyyu inna arsalnaka shahidan wa mubashshiran wa nadhira. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, O Prophet, we have sent you as a witness, a bearer of good news, and a warner. And this is a verse in Surah Al-Ahzab in verse number 45. And a protection for the unlettered. You are my slave and my messenger. I have called you the mutawakkil, which is the one who has trust in Allah, who is neither coarse nor harsh nor clamorous in the markets, who does not repay evil with evil, but pardons and forgives. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not take him until he has through him made the crooked community straight, so that they say, La ilaha illallah. And by that, the blind eyes and the deaf ears and the sealed hearts will be opened. It's an authentic narration. And here we have a description of one of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, describing him. And it was the practice of the companions and those who studied or followed them, the tabi'un, that they would want to know as much as they can about the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And the question posed to Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As radiyallahu anhuma was to give, to describe or give a description of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, strangely as it may sound, from the Torah. Okay, now we know that the Torah is the revelation that was sent down to Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. And we also know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala informed us that there has been some changes. There has been some distortion in that revelation. There was nothing in that revelation in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told the people that this revelation would be protected from people, i.e. that people may be able to change it, not like the Quran. And we know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in Surah Al-Hijr, إِنَّا نَحْنُ نَزَلْنَا ذِكْرًا وَإِنَّا لَهُ لَحَافِظُونَ, that indeed we sent down this remembrance, this dhikr, which is not only the Quran but also the Sunnah. Many of the mufassirun, many of the scholars of the past have interpreted this dhikr, this remembrance, is both the Quran and the Sunnah. And that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promises to preserve this revelation. Now we know that the Quran is untouched, unchanged, walillahi alhamd, but previous revelations, that they were tampered with. You may find, in these previous revelations, you may find some aspects of truth in it, as well as some aspects of باطل, or those matters which are false and go against the teachings of Al-Islam. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said concerning about narrations and statements and information that originates from Banu Israel. And it's important that we understand that our stance towards narrations or information that came before the advent of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, i.e. from Banu Israel. There are certain narrations that says that you can narrate from or concerning Banu Israel, which are called Al-Israiliyat. They're called Israiliyat narrations, okay? That the Prophet alayhi wasallam said, you can narrate from them, wala haraj, and there's no problem. However, there is an important principle that the scholars have mentioned. That when we find one hadith, it is important that we understand that hadith in light of many other narrations. And we don't just isolate that hadith. Okay? For example, there may be people who quote a narration of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam who says, جِئْتَكُمْ بِالذَّبْحِ جَزَكَ اللَّهِ خَيْرًا, that I came by slaughtering. This was a statement of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Okay? Really? There may be individuals who take this hadith and isolate this hadith to justify their hawa, their desires, their nafs, without looking at the whole picture. And this is not the way to look at and understand principles or any matter of Islam. So the fact that the Prophet ﷺ told us that you can narrate from Bani Israel, la haraj, no problem, isn't an open door policy for us to just go back to the Torah, go back to the Old Testament, the New Testament, and we were told we can go back to that and there's no problem in that. We have to bear in mind that there were other things that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam also told us concerning Israiliyat narrations. So for example, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in principle, we take from the many narrations that are mentioned concerning that, is that anything that we find from those Israiliyat which are in line with Islamic teachings, then we can authenticate it. Okay? But that what goes against Islamic teachings, we can say it's da'if. Not only is it da'if, but it may be something which a person introduced, okay, or entered into their teachings, which is clearly not correct. Okay? Now, it is very important that people who are not learned and are not able to distinguish when referring back to that, you know, for example, I'd like to know what the people of the book, what they say. So I want to go to the Bible and I want to do this and I want to do that. Not really having any really good, strong foundation knowledge in Islam and then go back to those books and then end up being really, really confused. Okay? So it's not just an open door policy concerning taking from Israiliyat, but rather you can, there are many, you know, Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma in his explanation of tafsir would refer to Israiliyat quite often. Okay, so anything that is in line with Islamic teachings can be maybe not as a primary evidence, but can be mentioned in passing, if you like. Okay, but anything that goes against Islamic teachings, then we can reject it. Then there may be things which talk, and you may find this, for an example, in Al-Bidaya wa Nihaya. Okay, a book by, it's called The Beginning and the End, by Imam Ibn Kathir rahimahullah, Al-Hafidh Ibn Kathir. He wrote a history book, and at the very beginning he talks about the creation of Adam alayhi salam, creation of the universe, and he will mention many things, and some of those things that he does mention are taken from Israiliyat, okay, from Banu Israel, children of Israel, their narrations. Some of those things we don't find in the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that either accept it or reject it. So it's in no man's land. So there's three types of narration. The first type of narration is what? I know we're divorcing, you know, quite a lot from what I've said, but inshallah we'll come back to this. The first narration is that what is in line with Islamic teachings. We can accept that, okay. And that what goes against Islamic teachings, which we can reject. And then there are those narrations which are in the middle, which Islam does not affirm nor deny. And as the Prophet ﷺ said, لَا نُكَذِّبُوا وَلَا نُصَدِّقُوا. We don't call it a lie, nor do we call it it's the truth. We say, Allahu alam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best, okay? So you would find that some of the Sahaba, some of the companions, radiallahu anhum, would have knowledge about other scriptures. One of these companions is Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As radiallahu anhu wa an abi, that he had some knowledge about other scripture. Hence, he was asked this question by Ata' ibn Yasar concerning the description of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And we also know by the Quran that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us regarding the people of the book, يَعْرِفُونَهُ كَمَا يَعْرِفُونَ أَبْنَاءُهُمْ, that they know the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam like they know their own children. So we know for sure that they had some knowledge about the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, namely the Jewish tribes in the Arabian Peninsula. And it is quite clear that there was a reason why these Jewish tribes were in this area in the first place. Okay? Because they were informed that towards the end of time, a prophet from Arabia would appear in these lands, hence them being there. And then when they heard that the Prophet ﷺ was from the lineage of Ismail ﷺ, they said, well, wait a minute, we were waiting for a prophet from the lineage of Ishaq ﷺ. He's not from our, what we thought he was going to come through the lineage of Musa and so on and so forth, ﷺ, okay? So they said, for whatever reason, we don't accept. Even though they know the haqq, even though they know the truth, they rejected it. So Abdullah ibn Amr ibn As radiallahu anhuma, he answered concerning the description of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, said, indeed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he made an oath that he is described with some characteristics that we find in the Quran. So what he is doing here, bearing in mind what I mentioned earlier, that he is mentioning, radiallahu anhu, something that Islam confirmed, that you'll also find in their revelation. Okay? Not bringing something which is in that no man's land that we can neither agree or say it is not true, but it is within that realm of saying this is something Islam confirmed. And he quoted the verse in Surah Al-Ahzab in verse number 45, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala addresses the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam by the if you like, a title or an honor that was given to him by Allah Jalla wa Ala as a prophet, Ya Ayyuhan Nabi. He was at times called Ya Ayyuhar Rasul, but never by his first name. You don't find in the Quran that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala addresses the Prophet alayhi wasalam by his first name, but addresses him by the title of either messengership or prophethood or as a mere servant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That he was sent as one of three things: Shahida, وَمُبَشِّرَا وَنَذِيرَا, as a witness, as a bringer of glad tidings, and also as a warner. So, what does it first mean that he sallallahu alayhi wasallam was a witness? That he is a witness over his people, that he delivered the message of La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah, and that also he alayhi salatu wasalam will be a witness over mankind on the Day of Judgment. وَكَذَلِكَ جَعَلْنَاكُمْ أُمَّةً وَسَطًا لِتَكُونَ شُهَدَاءَ عَلَى النَّاسِ, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells in Surah Al-Baqarah that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, وَكَذَلِكَ جَعَلْنَاكُمْ أُمَّةً وَسَطًا, that we made you an ummah of the middle path, أُمَّةً وَسَطًا, so that you would be a witness over mankind, on the Day of Judgment. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was a witness to what was delivered, that the message was complete, which is also mentioned later on in this particular narration. Also a mubashira, that he was also the bringer of glad tidings to inform them about the reward of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, i.e. the Jannah in the hereafter, and the guidance and the many things and blessings and mercies that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives to mankind. And also a nadhira, also as a warner about the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to those who will go against this particular message. So this is a verse in Surah Al-Ahzab and a protection for the unlettered. The unlettered meaning that he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was sent to an unlettered nation. An unlettered nation, And this is mentioned in Surah Al-Jumu'ah, هو الذي بعث في الأميين, that he is the one who sent to the unlettered nation, a messenger, أميين الرسول, a messenger sent to an unlettered people. Okay? And that he sallallahu alayhi wasallam yatlu alayhim, would recite the verses and purify them and teach them from the book and wisdom for matters that which that they were before ignorant to. And I have called you the mutawakkil, I have called you the one who has trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. These are all descriptions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam given to us by Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As radiyallahu anhuma. The one who is neither coarse nor harsh nor clamorous in the markets. Do you have that as well? You're not loud in the markets. So again, he's talking about the personality of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, that he was not a harsh person nor a coarse person when addressing people or loud in the markets, okay? And he doesn't repay evil with evil, but rather forgives and overlooks. And we know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in Surah Ali Imran in verse 159, فَبِمَا رَحْمَةٍ مِّنَ اللَّهِ لِنْتَ لَهُمْ وَلَوْ كُنْتَ فَضًّا غَلِيظَ الْقَلْبِ لَنْفَضُّوا مِنْ حَوْلِكَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in this verse, saying that by the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you were soft with them, you were easy with them. And if you were a person with a hard heart and harsh, then they would have fled and they would have run away from you. They would have simply just run away from you. Okay? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us this was the origin. This is how the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would deal with people. Likewise, he describes the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but rather forgives and overlooks. And we have the verse in Surah Al-Mu'minun, in verse number 96, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, اِدْفَعْ بِالَّتِي هِيَ أَحْسَنُ, that you should repel and whatever comes to you with that what is best. Whatever comes to you in the form of like bad behavior, you know, deal with that in the very best way, not in a bad way, okay? And we also have the verse that we took last week about وَعَارِضْ عَنِ الْجَاهِلِينَ, okay? That you should turn away from those ignorant people if they behave with you in this particular manner. Continuing, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the exalted, will not take him until he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, through him, has made the crooked community straight, so that they say La ilaha illallah. Now the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is complete. There's no deficiency in that. And we know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in Surah Al-Ma'idah, where the verse الْيَوْمَ أَكْمَلْتُ لَكُمْ دِينَكُمْ وَأَتْمَمْتُ عَلَيْكُمْ نِعْمَتِي وَرَضِيتُ لَكُمْ الْإِسْلَامَ دِينَ, this verse was revealed during the Hajj of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and we know that the religion was completed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. There is no need to add, there is no need to take something away from it, i.e. that it is somehow not needed anymore. Okay? It doesn't work like this. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to us a deen, a religion, which alhamdulillah is suitable for all people at all times. And the Prophet alayhi wasallam would remain amongst his community who were upon shirk, upon polytheism, upon disbelief, that he alayhi wasallam would remain with them until they were guided by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And as we know that before the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam passed away, that his people had embraced Islam and that they had دخلوا في الدين الله أفواجا, that they, by their droves they entered into the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that by their blind eyes, deaf ears and sealed hearts, metaphorically, not literally those blind people, but those people who had turned away from the religion and didn't want to know the haqq, that they would have the opportunity to know what the truth was. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would allow those people who are very staunch against the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, against the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that they would have the opportunity and the ability to know what the truth was. Now there's a long description here about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but going back to the title is cheerfulness towards people. And as we know here, we can see this through the description. This is all about bringing cheerfulness and good news. The fact that he, alayhi sallam, was a mubashira, a bringer of glad tidings, that this would bring happiness for people. Now, that was hadith number 246. 247 is Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah mentions the same narrator and just mentions a partial part of the previous hadith. Okay, so it's like almost like a slight repetition. Okay, so we don't need to explain that again. The next hadith narrated by Muawiyah radiyallahu anhu, he said radiyallahu anhu, I heard some words from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam by which Allah helped me. I heard the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam say, if you delve into suspicions about people, you will corrupt them. I therefore do not delve into my suspicions about people so that I may not corrupt them. Right. When it's translated into English, it sometimes just gives us like a single meaning. To have suspicion towards a person. Okay. However, what is mentioned in the Arabic, because as we know, inna ba'da dhan ithm. Okay. And the word dhan here is interpreted as what? Suspicion. So, and you have other words for suspicion as well. Like here is mentioned, riba. Okay? إِنَّكَ إِذَا اتَّبَعْتَ الرِّيبَ. Al-riba here has been translated as simply suspicion as well. But is there a difference between the two? The English language may not be able to express that in that way. However, the Arabic language is. And this word riba here is not only a suspicion amongst people, but also includes a claim and an accusation towards a person. That there is a suspicion, and then you make an accusation. Okay, so there are two things here. So it goes a step further, not just having dhan or some suspicion that you have within yourself, but rather you have a suspicion, and as it is mentioned, some of the ulama, they say, ashakku or shakka ma'at-tuhma, that you have some doubt about a person, and then you make that accusation. Okay? If you have that within yourself and you keep it within yourself and you have bad thoughts about Muslims without any right, you may carry that sin. But you may not necessarily cause fasad because you've kept it to yourself. Okay? You may deal with that person correctly. But here, what leads to the fasad, or what is mentioned in the hadith, what leads to the corruption of the people is what? Is the fact that you make an accusation about that suspicion that you have. Okay? So Mu'amr radiallahu anhu said, I heard some words from the Prophet alayhi wasallam that which by Allah's permission helped me. Okay? Referring back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that the nafi', that the real benefit ultimately is from who? It is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay? But I heard the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam say, if you delve into suspicion about people, this type of suspicion is that it is accompanied by accusations, then you will corrupt them. Now it becomes clear how the corruption can then occur. Because if you start accusing people, first and foremost, that suspicion, which is unfounded, you're not sure, you don't know, and then you add to that that you make the accusation, and then you ask that person, where did you get that from? 9 times out of 10, Fulan, somebody told me. Well, where did he get it from? I don't know. But I see him as a trustworthy person. He may well be a trustworthy person, but then you have to think to yourself, why did that individual tell you this information? That's an important point. Is that it may well be true or not true, but then what was the benefit of having that information and then giving it to another person? Would that not fall into backbiting? ذِكْرُكَ أَخَاكَ بِمَا يَكْرَهُ, mentioning something about your brother or about your sister which that they wouldn't like to hear. Would it not fall into that? Not unless you have, you know, well-established knowledge about people, and that when that knowledge is then given to other people, is there a need for that? For example, on the topic of backbiting, if you like, that, well, there are certain circumstances or situations where it is permitted for you to speak about another person, which that they may not like it. However, you won't carry a sin for it. You won't carry a sin for it, okay? So we're just sitting in a gathering here, and then we say, okay, you know, Fulan so-and-so, and then you start mentioning something about him that he did last week, and that, you know, that person maybe is embarrassing for them, or that they wouldn't want another person to know that. That's backbiting. You're not allowed to do that, okay? However, there may be circumstances where, let's say, for example, that person is involved in tijara, business. They buy and sell, okay? And you had dealings with them. You had dealings with them, and for whatever reason, you fell out over it, because you found out maybe they overcharged you, or they promised you something and it wasn't as it should be. And then somebody comes to you and then says, so and so wants to sell me what was sold to you. So then you say, what? This person is a cheater, and they're a deceiver. They said this to me, they said that to me. Never buy from that person. You may have been one person out of 100. The other 99 people, they were dealt with correctly. They got there as explained. But sometime, for whatever reason, and we're all bashar, all human beings, maybe they made a mistake in that particular transaction. But you have ruined that person in completely with the one dealing with you. Whereas if you are asked, you can say, well, what I know about the dealings with me, he dealt with other people, he deals a lot with other people. I don't know how that is, you may want to look at that. But with me, it didn't really work out. And if it was me, I wouldn't buy from him again, because what happened to me. So the person says, okay, give me the gory details. There's no need for that. There's no need for you to go into all those details. All you need to say is Qadr al-Haja. Just about what is necessary for you to mention about that person, so that they don't fall into a problem that you fell into. Okay? Or somebody oppressed you. Somebody stole your money. So you want to go to the police. So you go to the police and say, see that person, they stole their money. They stole my money. Would that person like that you are speaking about them? No, they don't like it. But it's your haqq. It's your right that was taken away from you. So you going to somebody and making a genuine complaint about another person is not considered backbiting. You have your right to go to ask somebody that Fulan or somebody wronged me, oppressed me, and I want my haqq back. You're allowed to do that. Or somebody comes to you in a matter of marriage, for example. What do you know about so-and-so? You mention what is necessary depending on their question. So they ask you, what do you know about this person? You know, this sister, she's maybe interested in marrying this particular individual, and they're looking about his salah, about his how he practices his deen. Does he attend lessons? Does he go to the masjid and things like this? And you reply, well, yes, he comes to the masjid now and again. They asked a question about a particular matter. Your answer should be directly answering what they asked for. Okay? Let's not consider, you know, maybe he doesn't come that often. Because that's what you see. I don't see him that often, but bearing in mind, I don't go that often as well. Okay, that could be the case as well. Because they may say, does he come to the masjid very often? You say, nah, not really. He himself doesn't even go to the masjid very often. So how can he make a judgment on that, okay? So sometimes the answer that is given can give the wrong impression. Secondly, the person says, you know, specifically about his practicing, attending lessons or the masjid or something like that. And they say, yeah, you know, he attends the masjid, alhamdulillah. But, you know, I went to school with him and he cheated in the exams. And we went on a travel together and we did this together. And I saw him speaking bad language. It's like, wait a minute, we didn't ask about all that information. That wasn't asked of you, but yet, mashallah, you decided to let your tongue go and start answering things that weren't asked of you. Here, you could fall into backbiting. But the point being here is that you may mention something about another person concerning marriage, which is a very important issue which would not fall into backbiting as long as you are giving the information which is necessary and not going beyond that. Okay, so there may be situations where you can mention things about other people, okay, which you would not fall into backbiting. Going back to the hadith, that if you delve into or fall into suspicion about people, you will corrupt them. I therefore do not delve into my suspicions about people so that I do not corrupt them. So immediately you find this was the advice of the Prophet ﷺ concerning a matter, and then you find immediate practice of that. Okay? There's the knowledge and there's the implementation immediately. It's not this is theory knowledge and you're teaching it, you know, we have a gathering here and we start talking about people, don't have suspicion and don't start making accusations, and then the person leaves the masjid and goes on a phone call and starts talking about fulan and fulana, did you hear this, did you hear that, yeah, I think they did it, why did you think, well, I just think, and so on and so forth. What's the point of all that beneficial knowledge when you're not implementing it? Okay, so this is an example of where the Sahaba radiallahu anhum would find the information, words from the Prophet ﷺ, and then would implement it straight away, because they knew the dangers of it. The next hadith is hadith number 249, narrated by Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu. However, the hadith has weakness in it. It's a hadith da'if. The hadith is weak due to one of the narrators. There's not much information about him. We don't know so much about him. His name is Abu Marzad, whose name is Abdul Rahman ibn Yassar, who is marked amongst weak narrators. And this particular narration is found in the Musannaf of Ibn Abi Shaybah. So it has some weakness concerning it, okay? So it is said here that these two ears of mine have heard and these two eyes of mine have seen the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Bearing in mind, we're still on the topic of what? Cheerfulness towards people. These two ears of mine have heard and these two eyes of mine have seen the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam take the palms of Al-Hasan or Al-Husayn radiallahu anhuma in both of his hands. So he holds them both like this. And his feet were on the feet of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So they're very small. So as a child, sometimes you do, you allow them to step on your feet and you take their hands and then you may raise them up, okay, like this. So the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, climb up. The boy did this so until he reached the chest of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, open your mouth. Then he kissed him and said, O Allah, love him, for I love him. Now, this last part of the hadith, meaning, O Allah, love him, for I love him, can be substantiated, can be authenticated elsewhere. The other part, we cannot. Okay? But this last point, we can. However, this hadith is mentioned here. Why? We see that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would play around with his grandchildren. And there are many incidences where even the Prophet ﷺ was in salah, was in prayer. And one of his grandchildren, radiallahu anhuma, would climb up on his back while he was in sujood. And he remained in this position while his grandson, radiallahu anhu, the grandson of the Prophet ﷺ, was climbing on his back. And he stayed in that position quite a while, longer than usual, until some of the companions who were praying behind, radiallahu anhum, thought something was up. So one of them raised their head to see what was going on, because it was unusual. Then at the end of the prayer, the Prophet ﷺ was aware, without having to be told. After the prayer, the Prophet ﷺ said, I stayed in this position because I wanted him to have his time. I didn't want to just move him, chuck him off. He was a small child. So I let him have his time on my back. He got off and then we continued the salah. Okay? So the Prophet ﷺ would, on all occasions, by any means possible, try to enter happiness into the people. Okay, no matter how small they were, or how old they were, regardless of this, even in ibadah, even during worship. Okay? And that he sallallahu alayhi wasallam would take his granddaughter as well and place her on his shoulder while praying. She shows the permissibility of holding your small child in salah. Why? Because just maybe placing them on the floor, maybe they feel afraid, you know, and they start crying. Okay, so to keep her happy, he sallallahu alayhi wasallam would hold her. And this is the shahid, this is the point of the mentioning of this narration. So that finishes that chapter. The next chapter that Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah mentions is Bab al-Tabassum, is the chapter of smiling. And here we have the hadith of Jarir radiallahu anhu, whose full name is Jarir ibn Abdullah radiallahu anhu. Now this particular sahabi became Muslim in the 9th year after Hijrah. Okay? So he said, since the time I became Muslim, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam never saw me without smiling at me. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam said on an occasion, a man from amongst the best of people of Yemen will enter by this door, and his face has an angelic touch. Now we need to move the hadith for you to wind. The hadith? So here Jarir radiallahu anhu mentions the fact that whenever he saw the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, or rather the Prophet alayhi wasallam would see him, he would see him and be looking at him in a state where he was smiling. And again, it's almost that this chapter is a more detailed, or is like more detailed of the chapter before. Chapter is just generally what? Putting or entering happiness into the hearts of people, or making people happy, cheerfulness towards people. The next chapter is an example of that. Okay? And this is a time for us to look at, you know, when the ulama, when they compile books, they didn't just, you know, right, I'm going to do this chapter now, I'm going to do this chapter. They thought very carefully about mentioning a chapter and the chapter that would come immediately after that. And you can see how they thought deeply about that. It wasn't just one from one chapter, there's a link between them. Okay? So having cheerfulness and happiness towards people, the next one is smiling, which is an example of that. Okay? And what is the sunnah concerning that? So then you may ask the question, how can you have a sunnah? Or what do you mean? I'm told when I can smile, how I should smile. We were given guidance concerning that, subhanAllah. And all of that is of benefit to us. So the example of that is the example of Jarir radiallahu anhu, that whenever the Prophet saw him, he would be smiling at him. This no doubt would make him feel very special and very happy. And that the companions in general, each one of them thought that they had that special relationship with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that nobody else had. He's my special friend. He's my close friend. I've got a link with him that nobody else has. Because the Prophet ﷺ, whenever he would deal with any of those companions, he would deal with them in a way that he gave them full attention. And if we mention in a couple of chapters time, that whenever the Prophet ﷺ would face somebody, he would face his whole body towards them. He would give them full attention. I.e., it wouldn't be like that your body's facing this way, you turn your head towards them. But rather, when the Prophet ﷺ would address somebody, speak to somebody, he would fully turn towards them. Which psychologically you feel that person is giving you their full attention. Okay? So whenever the Prophet ﷺ would speak to any companion, they would all think, I'm the closest to him. Until one of the companions said, Ya Rasulullah, who is the most beloved? He wanted a test. You know, who is the most beloved person to you? Who's closest person to you? And he answered, Aisha radiallahu anha. She said, oh, okay, you know, that's his wife. Okay, what about the thumma man? Then who? Then her father, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu. Then he realized that, you know what? Maybe I'm not number one. So he said, I'm not going to ask anymore. But this is the feeling that they had, towards the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And imagine that this companion, that whenever the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam saw him, he would smile at him. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would smile towards people, not because he was angry with them, but because he loved them, and because he had an attachment to that person. And when you smile at a person, what are you offering? You're offering some form of mawaddah, some form of, maybe love is a strong word, because maybe you walk in the street and you smile at somebody, it doesn't mean you love them, okay? But some form of niceness, if that's a word, some form of goodness towards another person, okay? And the smile has different levels. There's the, the quick one, and then there's the one that continues. And it's a form of charity. Maybe you don't have any money, you don't have very much to give your brothers and things like that, but when you see them, you have a smiling face, you have a happy face, and then in turn, khalas, he ain't got no problem with me, alhamdulillah. Okay? He don't have no problem with me, I got no problem with him, and everything is good. Okay? So this is the sunnah concerning this issue, and the example of the Prophet ﷺ concerning this particular companion. Shall we have enough time to take the next hadith? That was hadith 250. We're now on hadith number 251, where's the narration of Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha. She said, I never saw the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam laugh in such a way that the back of his throat could be seen. Rather, he used to smile. She also said, radiallahu anha, when he saw a cloud or wind, in, where there's like a storm or something like that, okay? And you say, well, how do you see the wind? Well, when you're in the desert, you'll know, okay? Because you see all the sand being blown up and the dust, okay? You'll see it. It's not like here, okay? Concrete jungle, you don't see those things. So whenever he'd see a cloud or a wind, unease could be seen in his face. I asked, O Messenger of Allah, when the people see a cloud, they rejoice. Okay, when it's clouds in the desert, and they're kind of dark clouds, means it's rain, okay? And you don't get a lot of rain in the desert, so they're happy. However, when you see it, I see an unease in your face. He said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, O Aisha, how can I be sure that there is no painful chastisement in it? People have indeed been chastised by the wind. Some have seen such punishment and said, this is a rain cloud coming to us. Now the hadith mentions more than one thing, but the point is that Aisha radiallahu anha mentions that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to smile a lot. Now, she also mentions that he wouldn't laugh in a manner, where you'd see the back of his throat, which indicates a type of laughter where the person is maybe rocking their head back with their mouth wide open, uncontrollable laughing. That he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, would not laugh in that manner. Okay? But he would show happiness. And as is mentioned, and if you look carefully, subhanAllah, about the narration that has been chosen, okay, you will see that they would look at the face of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to see if he was happy, or to see if he was not quite happy, or there was an unease about his mood. His face, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, would give off how he was feeling. And an example of that, when the people would just see rain clouds and so on and so forth, mashallah, is rain coming. But the Prophet alayhi wa sallam, in his response, would allow the people to reflect and think about that rain that may come to us. And an example of that is a man, he came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam on a Friday, and he complained about like a mini famine, the rain hasn't come to us. There's a hadith of Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu, it's in both Bukhari and Muslim, that he said, no rain has come to us, make dua for us. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam immediately made dua, until the companions then they said, when the Prophet ﷺ had finished the dua, we could see rain clouds coming beyond the mountains, straight away, until the rain came down, subhanallah. And it continued and continued and continued till the following week. And the man came and said, O Messenger of Allah, make dua that Allah stops the rain. It's too much. It's flooding the place. Then the Prophet ﷺ made dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that have the rain around us and not on top of us. Okay? So where there was a point in time where they wanted rain so much, and when the rain came, they then complained. Then the Prophet ﷺ asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that the rain then be of benefit to us. And the most authentic narration concerning rain that we know is Allahumma sayyiban nafi'a. Okay, oh Allah, make this a beneficial rain. And then you can make any other dua that you like. And when the rain is finished, mutirna bi fadlillah, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, by his blessings, it rained. Okay, you make these supplications as well. So the Prophet ﷺ mentioned that what we may see as a ni'mah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, like the rain, it could cause harm to us. Okay, so it's important for us to reflect on that, inshallah ta'ala. And here we'll stop. And we'll continue next week, inshallah ta'ala. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Subhanallah, 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 alhamdulillah. Subhanallah, 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 alhamdulillah. Subhanallah, subhanallah.